Did you feel it? Yeah. Were you excited to walk into this theatre and find 2,500 percussion instruments? Yeah. Or were you surprised, maybe looking for that quick exit? Or were you thinking, well, I'm not sure about this. I don't have a musical bone in my body. I can fully understand that there are certain insecurities and anxieties that are associated with walking into a room and finding a bunch of instruments that you may have never played before and then having to sit through an interactive performance. Can I do this? And will I be picked upon? And for me, one of the definitions of success with this performance is to see how many perceptions I can dissolve, how many attitudes and opinions I can change from, well, I'm not sure about this, to, hey, that was actually quite cool. I enjoyed it and I did it. And that's not always easy. Once I recall there was a woman sitting in the middle of the audience and she was staring at me through the entire show with her fingers in her ears like this. It's true, through the whole show. But very off-putting for me, and I lost my focus several times. What I learned very early on with these performances is to really focus on the positive energy. All right, anything negative, I just had to ignore it and completely eliminate it, and later actually turn it actually into something. I learned how to change it into something positive. So my rhythm interactive journey began in 2003 with 30 drums in a garage in Queenstown. And we had a small team at that stage. We had a dream to create the coolest and biggest interactive musical performance. And we wanted to do this using percussion instruments and drums, but more so to do this without speaking a single word as part of the theme, action speaks louder than words. So we sat down with a blank piece of paper and I started writing down, coolest interactive percussion show, I will do this, and then the audience will, I will do this, and then... It was a very difficult task because I realized very quickly that what I needed was a live audience. I needed a live audience to experiment with. And as I said, I was living in Queenstown at that time, and we came up with an idea to hang posters in local backpackers that said, trial audience wanted for live percussion show, free barbecue and beer afterwards. Now that worked. Now, we did a series of these trial shows and we collected all the notes, and those notes were transformed into a template, and that became the template of our performance. It was good, but it didn't always work. And I still remember our very first school show that we did. We arrived at the school and we spoke to the teacher in charge, and they said, she said, the show today is going to be for 240 people. And we set up 240 drums in the school hall. We got ourselves organized on stage. We were ready, and our audience walked in. 245-year-olds. Yeah. Now, as you can imagine, 10 minutes into this performance, without me, with me not having spoken a single word, these kids were looking at me as to go, what on earth is going on, man? And then this little girl, this little 5-year-old girl, she hopped up on stage and tapped me on the leg and she goes, can you please talk? It was very cute. But what I learned from that was that this template that we created didn't fit our audience each and every time. Okay, sometimes our group would consist of 200 female doctors or admin staff. Other times we would have 300 male engineers. And yet other times, again, we would have a group of 5 and 6-year-old school children. It didn't always fit. And things kind of changed for us in 2008. There was a change. There was almost something magical that started to happen. And what had happened was that for me, the performances became effortless. I was no longer trying to apply a template to each and every performance. I was no longer meticulously trying to chomp through a series of steps that made up a show. But instead, I started reading the audience and reading the energy and listening and looking for feedback, immediate feedback from the audience, and tweaking it as I went along. Is it going too fast? Is it going too slow? Is there a massive delay because we've got 3 different levels and tambourines up there? Yes. You know, all these things, I was tweaking it as I went along, and I created a series of techniques that enabled me to grab the audience's attention, but maintain it. Maintain a momentum of the performance that kept people intrigued, but at the same time, allowing the performance to breathe So people had time to reflect what's going on and, hey, I'm actually doing this. So that gave me something else that changed. What happened there? The performance had taken on a new style. And the style the performance had taken on was total improvisation. And this way, the show became unique and completely geared to each audience. But there was another change. There was another change that happened, and the change was within me. Because believe me, I had my own fair amount of insecurities and anxieties walking in front of a group of people who had given instruments that they perhaps had never played before, and then I was going to stand here and not speak a single word, and with a whole bunch of funny facial expressions, trying to get these people to understand and hopefully do what I wanted them to do. Yeah, can you imagine that first show? Yeah? I'll be standing behind the curtain going, are they going to do it? Are they going to get it? Are they going to like it? And the people were coming in going, hey, instruments, not sure if I can do this. Not sure if I'm into this. Oh, well, that's kind of the battle of the anxieties, you know. But once I let go, once I became completely committed, you know, that's what it is. It's about completely having no, you know, showing your vulnerability, showing your true colors, and completely committing yourself to this performance and putting your total trust that each performance is going to be the best one ever and that you're going to make your audience shine. That's when things changed. And for me, I would enter a certain zone with the performance. I'd go into a place with full awareness and focus and a beautiful place to be. And what I figured out was I was actually entering a state of flow. And the state of flow is defined as somebody who's completely immersed in an activity, totally focused, and in the absolute moment of now. And the more I entered a state of flow, the easier it became for me to lead my audience into a state of collective flow. Collective flow. A group of people totally immersed in an activity, absolutely focused, and totally in the moment of now. And believe me, when you have your group or your audience that engaged, you can see it in people's eyes. They're not thinking about what they're going to be cooking for dinner that night. So once we realized that we could do this and that we could create collective flow, we started to ask ourselves the questions, how are we actually doing this? And can we teach people? So we came up with a series of languages that we use consistently to create this collective flow. We started to unpack these. We started to analyze them. We started to document them. And we're currently creating a workshop because we feel that anyone can learn these languages. Anyone can create collective flow. Okay? And imagine the possibilities. If we all can create collective flow on a regular basis, imagine what that would do for sports teams, music groups, businesses, teachers, governments, academic units, even families. They would work better and achieve more. Imagine what that could do to our future. Thank you.